There's a look at Prince, who has been their ace this season with 21 wins, but Redflake getting the start, and we're underway here in game two. Leah Bowen calling balls and strikes as Danica Mercado looks at the first one on the corner. Mercado tops on the team in runs scored and had a huge regional where she was 5 for 10, was 0 for 3 though in game one here at the Supers. Redflake, the most improved Wildcat, swinging the bat as a slapper and has been their number two pitcher all season long. That's back through the circle. And reaching safely is Mercado with an infield single.
We all know the importance of Oregon's leadoff Mercado, and she just kind of gets a little piece of this thing. So much speed up the line. I mean, it's a no-brainer. She's safe. That's what Oregon needs, Mercado, and she gets on base. Chances are she's going to steal and be in a big RBI situation for those 2-3-4 hitters.
Now the speedy Alexis Mack, as you look at Mike White, eighth season, 8 straight Supers trips, Women's College World Series in 12, 14, and 15, trying to get back there. And he is a team that is so versatile and has plenty of speed. Mack, their leading hitter on the year. Going to lay the bunt down. It's a beauty right in front of the plate. And a discussion here.
We'll see what that call is.
She's going to get the bat back here, and I think they're going to call that a foul at the plate. And here comes Rachel Lawson with wanting an explanation.
I thought for a second that that umpire was going to call Mercado out for leading off, because it looked like it was a pretty good bunt by Mack. And we'll take a look. I mean, looks pretty good to me. Her foot was maybe out of the box a little bit, but still touching the chalk line. She didn't step on home plate. I'm not entirely sure up here.
2-1 now. They say it was officially called a foul ball as it hit the bat twice.
Yeah, that angle was just a little tough for us to see, but yeah, it might have ricocheted.
She's going to lay it down this time. Same spot, and a good play made there by Cheek to retire the speedy Mack. That does get Mercado down to second base on the sacrifice. Cheek really good on that left side of the infield.
And you have to be so quick. Mack turning early, Cheek all over it. She fires a strike to first. But Mack doing her job. Something we didn't see a lot of yesterday. Teams sacrificing to move runners over and put them in scoring position. And perfect with Svekas stepping up.
And now Svekas, the RBI machine with 40 on the year. Chance to give the Ducks the early lead here. He is 5 for 11 in the postseason. Second in home runs. Third in RBIs, breaking for third, the runner, safe at third base, Mercado strikes third.
And you love that Gwen Svekas goes to bunt to kind of mix up the catcher a bit, and you see Mercado, she slides in safe. Heads up base running for sure, but it was Svekas sticking that bunt out, kind of getting in the catcher's eyes a little bit.
And now it's 3-0.
And Redflake frustrated. You see her kind of throw her hands up there, and that's the importance of the first inning. It sometimes can be so difficult to try to find that umpire strike zone. And I'm sorry, but the trend in this NCAA tournament is umpire zones are quite small.
There's a strike, late call on the inside corner. Megan Prince looking on. She's an option if Rethlake gets in trouble. Three-one fouled off. Third team all-conference junior from Davie, Florida, who found her swing in game one of this regional. That is a good sign for the Ducks. Their middle part of the order hadn't been swinging the bats quite as well in the postseason prior to the Supers, as she fouls another one off. Fifth straight season, Oregon is hosting a Super Regional. Last year, lost to UCLA on this field. Unfinished business coming into this year. Here's a 3-2. Ball four, runners on the corners. Now Mike White's gonna bring in a pinch runner here. Cherish Burks will run for Svekas at first.
There was a big situation yesterday with Svekas on first base where he did not pinch run, and she was a big out call at home. So I think Coach White, understanding with one out on the board, it's a smart decision to put in Burks, their fastest runner, their go-to pinch runner, especially with Udria stepping to the plate.
Coach White going through the signs. And he has one of the best Ducks in school history at the plate here with an opportunity. The leader in home runs and RBIs, breaking for second is Burks. She'll take second base with the steal. No throw made there, and that eliminates the force play.
It's a big situation here for Udria, senior leader in RBIs, home runs. One out here for them to come up with a couple RBIs in the first inning would be big for them.
Udria, first team all Pac-12, all region. She drove in four runs here in Eugene. Impressive numbers, power hitter. And Rethlake's been falling behind. Not a good sign here in the first inning.
And it just kind of makes you think, is it quite a tight leash with Rethlake? You don't have a lot of wiggle room. I mean, this is a must win for UK.
Curve misses. Now it's 3-1. You've got first base open, but Shannon Rhodes, a hot hitter on deck.
And that curveball for Rethlake is what she needs to feel good. And she's missing a ton out of the zone with that.
Grounder backhanded by Reed. They're coming home. They've got the runner, Mercado, in the rundown. And the tag out. A big play for the Kentucky defense. Ducks now have runners at second and third. That's out number two.
What a huge play for Reed. Such a stud. She makes a great grab on this. They get Mercado in a big rundown. Cheek able to get her. And that's what you need, those heads up plays. There was a play like that for them yesterday that they were not able to execute.
Rhodes first pitch swinging. Cheek has it, and the Wildcats get out of the inning. Rethlake struggles, but no damage done. We're through half a frame. Game two, Supers, Ducks, and Wildcats. Scoreless as we go to the bottom of the first. Oregon trying to punch their ticket to the Women's College World Series in Oklahoma City. Kentucky trying to keep their season alive. And Oregon with a sensational freshman. Her first super start, Maggie Ballant.
And she has done a terrific job all year long. But let's not forget, this is a way different scale. So he's given the freshman the ball. Clean slate for her. She just has no idea what postseason is about. So we'll see what she's made of. But a little scouting report on her. That screwball is her go-to. She throws it low in the zone, cuts into righty's hands. See that, finding the umpire's zone early. Rethlake struggled a little bit last inning trying to find it. Ballant has to come out. And those are things you recognize as a pitcher, that the other pitcher's struggling. You want to find it early.
The Wildcats lineup brought to you by Capital One. And you see the number two and number eight hitters. That's a switch. Schaefer and Vick batting in those spots in the order for just the second time this year. So Coach Lawson mixing it up and hoping to get some production from that bottom half.
and you like that Vix move down to the bottom. She's struggled a little bit in postseason play, but she's usually been that typical two-hole hitter. But moving her down, she can turn the lineup over quicker, and it also takes a little bit of pressure off of her in that eight slot.
Coach Lawson, 9 straight NCAAs, 5 supers as a 14th seed in 2014. They made it to Oklahoma City, hoping that's a good omen this year. Katie Reed to lead things off against Maggie Ballant. First pitch bouncer. Udrea bobbles it. No play can be made, and Reed is aboard.
You see the game plan right away. Swinging early. Reed swings at that first pitch. Udrea just not able to handle it.
Infield single for Reed. Here's Jenny Schaefer, the catcher. And they crash in on the corners. Boy, what a different mindset. And when you can get that leadoff hitter on, Schaefer can really set up the power hitters now at the top of the order. Bunt's in the air, though. Caught by a diving Caluso. One down.
And Schaefer gotta get this down, but Caluso with the dive in play lays out big, gets up knowing Reed's got some speed. Huge out for Oregon, but UK, you have to find a way to get that down.
How about the freshman from Redding, California with a highlight reel play? Brooklyn Hines, first pitch, and that one's gonna make it into left field for a base hit. Bobbling it, the left fielder, Mack. Hines with the hit, and coming around to score is Reed, and the Wildcats are on the board first. Single and then the air, and Kentucky showing their speed.
And if anyone should know this outfield and how the turf plays, it should be Mack. You see the hop that this takes, the big hop. She tries to bare hand, not able to do it. Huge error in the outfield, very costly. Reed is a for sure home on this, and Hines able to leg out the triple and is in scoring position again with only one out.
And this is a very good sign for Kentucky. When the Wildcats score the first run this season, they're 29-3. And in an elimination game here, they put themselves in a really good spot after Rethlake worked out of some problems in that top half. And now their hottest hitter in the postseason, Alex Martin, steps up. Five for seven, drove in 5 runs in the Lexington Regional, an RBI chance.
You see, all of this has happened, and Ballant only has 4 pitches on the board. I mean, she really hasn't had to throw a lot of pitches. There's just been a couple big plays that didn't turn out in Oregon's favor.
National Freshman of the Year finalist Maggie Ballant from West Grove, Pennsylvania. Martin's also a freshman from McHenry, Illinois. Fouls that one off. I mean, you're looking at 2 of the top freshmen in the country in this matchup here.
You like how Ballant gets ahead quickly. I mean, there's been a lot of things out of her control here. A run scored, a couple errors, but she jumps out 0-2.
Lifted in the air to left. Mack was playing in, and it's over her head, and it goes to the fence. That will score Hines, 2-0 Kentucky. Opposite field, Martins delivers.
Martins is a power hitter. Take a look at Mack in left field. Martins just kind of hammers this, and it it looked like it would be a routine play, but Mack is actually in a little bit. She steps forward on that. And Kentucky able to come up with another big run.
Here's another first pitch swing as Cheek fouls it back. The Cats have been so aggressive, just going after her early in the count.
And she's a freshman out there. There's a lot going on. You want to try to get in her head right away. You know pitchers throw strikes early. So to come out absolutely hacking, that's what they've done. Oregon's had a couple miscues defensively.
So three of the five Kentucky hitters have swung at the first pitch, and it has worked out very well for them. Cheek all about power this year. Two and one. All right, get into the head of the freshman here. You mentioned your first super start. She's rattled, and she hasn't been rattled much this season.
No, and postseason is completely different. I mean, the Women's College World Series is almost there. They can almost touch it. That's a lot of pressure, and everyone deals with it differently. I mean, it's plenty of game left. It's the first inning. But like I said, those little errors, Max made a couple in left field, and Udrea with that bobble with Reed right off the bat. I mean, they haven't started out rather clean, and I think those are the types of things that can get in balance head a little bit.
Popped up. Lindvall on the infield dirt, two away. And we saw Rethlake struggle, but she battled through it. Not the case here for Ballin.
And they came up with that huge defensive play. Reed was able to get Mercado out at home. Like, just coming up with the big plays. Defense wins championships. You got to step it up.
Now Breanne Ray, the right fielder, the senior from Benton, Kentucky. Pops it up, same spot, and Lindvall again. She has it, and that ends the inning. Two runs for Kentucky, three hits, a stranded base runner. Good start through one frame for Rachel Lawson's team. Backs to the wall, Wildcats up 2-0.
Success doesn't happen overnight. It's a journey, each step drawing you closer to your goal. Every rep, practice, pitch, the emotional highs and lows, hours of hard work leading to that final out and a chance at immortality. This is where it all begins. The journey lives here.
All roads lead to Oklahoma City, USA Softball Hall of Fame Stadium. It'll start Thursday on ESPN, noon Eastern time, and the finals Monday through Wednesday, June 5th through the 7th. What a great setting, and one of these teams will be there, either the Oregon Ducks or the Kentucky Wildcats. Cats' only appearance was in 2014. Oregon trying to get there for the fourth time under Mike White. But the Wildcats off to a good start here as Mia Canuso swings the first pitch to start off the second and flies out to Hines in center field. One away. Well, it has to be a sense of relief for Rethlake getting through that rocky first inning. Now you would think she can relax and breathe a little bit easier out there.
For sure. When your defense comes up and makes big plays for you, makes you feel good, and then not to mention they come back and put two runs up on the board. That has to give you a little bit more just reassurance heading into the top of the second inning, feeling good. And this is exactly what Kentucky needs. They obviously, it was a little bit of a shocker throwing Rethlake out there. Everyone assumed Prince. I mean, it was on the lineup and they made the split decision.
Miranda Ellis, bouncer to Reed in time, two down. Yeah, so much talk about Megan Prince. She's had the lion's share of the innings this year, 199 plus. Rethlake just 99 innings, but Coach Lawson, that shows the confidence she has in Erin Rethlake.
And it's an ideal situation because if things get rocky, they have a lead, they can bring Prince in. They can save some innings. UK has to beat Oregon twice, so Prince is going to get more innings if they're able to find a way to get to game three, and she will probably make an appearance in this game sometime today too.
Last year, 46 wins and made it to an NCAA regional, lost to Utah. She was named SEC Coach of the Year. This year, looking to not only win a regional, but a super. And it's a young team, but the chemistry is so good with this Kentucky outfit.
Chemistry is key, especially postseason.
Off-speed pitch to Linval is in there, 2-1.
And Rethlake coming in this inning, getting two very quick outs. Finding a way to get her team back in there to keep that momentum going.
Yeah, both of these teams young. Kentucky, three senior leaders, but sophomores have helped out the freshmen. And Mike White's team, wow, they're here to stay for a long time with their squad. A lot of talented freshmen and sophomores. Full count. Full house, which is what they're accustomed to here at Sanders Stadium. Sunny skies and a tremendous setting for softball. That's foul down the line. Oregon in this postseason, they've scored 32 runs. They've allowed just 7. It's not often they have to come from behind. I mean, when you're 51-6, you expect to be out in front early and cruise home.
We have the ninth pitch coming to Linval. She's having a heck of an at bat.
Got a piece of that one.
And Rethlake already at 31 pitches, only in the second inning. I mean, that's a lot of pitches. Linval making her work.
Hit hard into right field for a base hit. Second hit for the Ducks.
What a heck of an at bat by Linval. She goes down and gets this. Sneaks it right by that 3-4 hole. Martin's laying out, but Linval, great piece of hitting. Wasn't that bad.
Now Jenna Lilly, the ninth place hitter, has had a tremendous career and has found her swing late season. Struggled throughout this year, a lot of times working in the cages and drinking some coffee with the coach to get her game right, and it's been right of late. Backhanded by Metzger, that'll end the inning. That Kentucky defense, very tough. We're through an inning and a half. Wildcats up 2-0. You're looking at the Oregon Administration Building, made famous by John Belushi in Animal House. Great start for Kentucky here. Game two of the Super Regionals, leading Oregon 2-0. The Cats getting two runs on three hits off of freshman Maggie Ballant. And now it'll be Rachel Metzger leading things off, the seventh place hitter for the Wildcats. Erin Rethlake getting the surprise start in place of Megan Prince just seconds before the start of this game, and it surprised a lot of us, including us here upstairs, but it was a good move by Lawson, it appears.
Yeah, and I mean, there's a lot more ball game left, but.
Metzger retired 6-3 on the put out there.
You have to remember that Kentucky has to win too. So if they do go balls to the wall and they want to throw Prince, that they still have to win another game. So you have to understand, if Rethlake can go out there and throw some scoreless innings and keep doing what she's doing, then, I mean, they're in a good position, keeping the senior on the bench, giving her a little bit of a break.
Now Bailey Vick, who is one for her last 11 at the plate in this postseason. Prince was on the lineup card, and everyone assumed that's the way she would go, but a change of heart, and it has worked wonderfully. We're only through an inning and a half. Vic to third. Lilly with a quick play, two down. Thank you, Eric. We're in Eugene, Oregon at Jane Sanders Stadium. The Oregon Ducks and Kentucky Wildcats battling in game two of this best of three series. Oregon winning game one 4-0, but Kentucky has come out playing some great softball here behind the pitching of Aaron Rethlake and a big two-run first inning. Oregon looking for their fourth Women's College World Series trip in the last 6 years. Kentucky trying to get back there for the first time since 2014. Aaron Rethlake with a slow roller to Udrea, short, just in time by half a step, and now in the inning. Three up and three down, Ballant a solid second inning, but the Wildcats in front by two as we move to the third. Here in Eugene, a bit of a surprise. Aaron Rethlake getting the start, has a 2-0 lead to work with, and we see Megan Prince, the ace, warming up now for Kentucky just in case. Top of the order for the Ducks. Danica Mercado leading things off. Infield single, first time up for the right fielder, senior from Temecula, California. First team all Pac-12 this year. That's fouled off, and no one able to get there as left fielder Vic gave a look. Mercado, the leader in runs scored, second in stolen bases this year. She is dangerous when she gets on the base pass. And much like facing Prince, they're getting a left-hander here in Rethlake, and it's a different look.
Yeah, they got to see that lefty yesterday, so getting to see back-to-back lefties should not be as hard for them to make those adjustments on.
It's hit on the nose, Reed with it, and there's one down. The 101st running of the Indianapolis 500 this Sunday. It's on ABC, continuing the Memorial Day weekend tradition. Our pre-race coverage begins at 11 Eastern, 8 Pacific, followed by the greatest spectacle in racing at noon Eastern time. Everything also streaming live on the ESPN app and watch ESPN. Here's Alexis Mack. She's also a threat on the base pass, and tremendous year, and you'd have to say one of the top transfers in softball this year out of, it was at South Carolina where she started 40 games for the Gamecocks and hit 341 a year ago. Chopper over the circle. Martin's moving to a right, not in time.
Just so much speed. I mean, Martins, there's just no way that she's going to be able to get her out. She hits that a little bit up the middle. Martins has to go get it. But Mack, so much speed.
And it sets up Gwen Savekas, who walked her first trip. Mack, the Pac-12 stolen base leader. Have to keep a close eye on her. Rethlake, a junior from Huntington, Indiana. One ball, one strike.
There's not many more pitches that you're going to get like that, that miss over plate, that are right there, hammer pitches.
Here's a strike, 1-2. Different start for Kentucky than they saw in game one. They trailed 1-0. Ducks put up a big three-run inning to break it open. This time they have Oregon on their heels. That's hit hard into left field. Base hit Savekas. Well, she is feeling it now after a couple hits in game one, a solid single to left.
And she takes that pitch low in the zone and goes down and gets it. Great piece of hitting by Svekas. Turns on this. Right through that 5-6 hole and passes the bat to Udria. A couple runners on. One out. Big inning here for Oregon.
Udria first pitch swinging, tagging the bag as Cheek on the first. Double play, and the Cats defense does it again. The Kentucky D so solid on that left side with Cheek and Reed, and they're making all the plays right now to help out Refway.
This play, Cheek steps on the bag, throws it, knows the top of the lineup's coming up.
Oregon the site, and the NCAA Softball Super Regionals presented by Capital One continues as Kentucky tries to stave off elimination here. If necessary, game three coverage Sunday, 3 Eastern time on ESPNU. The winner of this series will play Utah or Washington in the Women's College World Series in Oklahoma City. All games streaming live on the ESPN app and watch ESPN. Kentucky with 2 in the first, and that is stood up, and now it's the top of the order, Katie Reed against Maggie Ballant. See the Ducks crashing in at the corners at first and third. Reed has the ability to lay one down with her speed.
Usually you see a lot of leadoffs batting lefty. Reed a righty can drop that bunt, take her hacks.
Good situational hitter. She made the move from second base to shortstop this year. And a leader, the most competitive Wildcat. Second in the SEC in batting average in conference games at .380. And she is going to have a tremendous career. Look out in her junior and senior campaigns. That one's going to find the seats behind the netting behind home plate. Lifted down the line and foul. First team all SEC. Her sister Bailey played softball at Drexel. It's in the family. Out in front of that one and out of play.
And Ballant has a lot to play with here. I mean, she has a 1-2 count. She's able to bring that ball high up in the zone. She's got a tight spinning rise ball. She should try to bring something way up and out of Reed's wheelhouse here to just get her thinking, because Reed is pretty much swinging at anything right now.
Goes away with that one, 2-2. Fouls it back. Reed, one of the Wildcats we talked to prior to the Supers, and she just has that calm demeanor about her.
Oh, and I mean, we asked her, have you been this type of leader your whole life? And she said, you know, I've really led by example all the way up until I got to UK. And then after last year, I was more of a vocal leader, and she's real comfortable being that for Kentucky.
Out of St. Louis, as you look at Oregon with Miranda Elish warming up, the freshman who picked up a win in the regional against Wisconsin.
This is the 10th pitch of the at bat coming to Reed. What an at bat, making Ballant work. You saw Elish in the pen, and she's in that DP spot so she can come in at any time.
Do you notice that as a pitcher? Her first few swings weren't good ones. She's out in front and behind, but she seems to be on now over the last couple pitches.
Well, I mean, you look at how many. She's going on her 11th pitch, and you're seeing a lot. So you're on time. The more you see a pitcher, you're on time. So seeing a lot of pitches.
Hits that hard to short. Udrea just got her by about half a step. One away.
And Reed thinks she's safe. This will be the perfect look. And she looks safe, folks. She had her hands up in the safe position after. And I think Udrea wasn't expecting that much speed from Reed up the line.
It's a big out. Here's Jenny Shaper. Little flare out in the right field. That's going to find the turf. Base hit. Let's get a studio update. Here's Adnan Vert. Thank you, Adnan. Couple of SEC teams squaring off there with a lot on the line. Kentucky in an SEC Pac-12 matchup with Oregon in this one. The Ducks taking game one 4-0, but it's been Kentucky's day so far, and they have a runner aboard with one down and Brooklyn Hines at the plate. Singled, first trip up there. Strike call.
And that is a pretty pitch by Ballin. If she can consistently get that pitch thrown like that in on righties, that tight screwball spin, for Hines to try to turn on that will be very difficult. The most she can do is probably foul that off.
Faced one high in the zone, and there's a strikeout for Ballin, her first of the game.
And she goes upstairs, and that's the importance of jamming, and then going up with that rise ball. Ballin hasn't had to use it a ton, but she should use it more for reasons like that. Gets in Hines' head, thinks she's going in, and then she's able to sneak one up under her hands.
Now Alex Martins, strike one. Great at bat, first time up, going opposite field with a double to drive a run in. With Mack playing in a bit in left field.
And Mack learned now, she's way back.
Here's a look at Alexis, you see the track there.
Yeah,
and she backs up towards it.
Warning track city there.
Grounder to short. To the bag unassisted, Udrea, and that'll end the inning. 2-0, Kentucky leads it. We're through three innings. Ducks coach Mike White will be with us when we come back. The Ducks trailing here at Sanders Stadium. 2-0 game here, game two. Super regionals from Eugene, Oregon as we move into the fourth inning. We're joined by Oregon head coach Mike White. Coach, talk about your approach against Rethlake versus Prince, a left-hander, but you have made some contact.
Well, yeah, she's a little quicker, so we got to be on time, and I think we're moving the ball pretty well. They're playing good defense, and we're not executing, so we got to change those.
Hey, Coach, what's the conversation you have with your team heading into this game? Obviously, last year it didn't work out in your favor, but what's the conversation heading into game two?
Well, I think a couple of our players took over their first innings to their defense and made a couple of miscues, and you can't do that. We just basically gave them two runs, and they're too good a team to do that to.
Perfect. Thanks so much. Good luck, Coach.
Thanks.
Shannon Rhodes leading things off for Oregon, down 2-0. Last year, they won game one against UCLA 8-1, dropped the final two games to the Bruins, and unfinished business. It's been in the back of their minds all season long.
And it was a heartbreaker game two for them. They were winning all the way until the seventh inning, and Gabby Maurice hits a home run to tie it, to put them to extra innings, where UCLA came out on top. But it was their offense that was quiet. Game one, they came out explosive last year, 8-1. I mean, you think Oregon's got it in the bag. Game two, I mean, completely different story. So that's where they need to turn it around today. So you don't want to go to game three. I feel like the winner Kentucky wins this, they take that momentum into game three. They're feeling it. They have nothing to lose. Oregon has everything to lose.
And the Wildcats will likely have Prince waiting in the wings. She could pitch today, get the start tomorrow. Pitch to Rhodes is inside, and Redflake falls behind 3-0. There's Megan Prince. She has been the workhorse. 7 wins against the top 25 this year. Ball 4. Last thing Redflake wants to do, Rhodes is on, and she has speed.
Redflake not even close to Rhodes. I mean, 4 straight balls. That's where she has to be better. I mean, you have a 2-run lead right now. You need to limit those free passes. You can't keep giving that excuse of pitcher trying to find the strike zone here. We're in the 4th inning. She's got to find a way to get ahead and limit what just happened to Rhodes.
Now Mia Camuso, ball 1. Melissa Spellman warming up.
And I like Coach Lawson calling time. I mean, that's 5 straight balls from Redflake just to go out and have a conversation. Lawson, the pitching coach, she calls pitches. Just kind of talking with her pitcher, calming her down a little bit. And sometimes when you're trying and you're pressing to throw strikes, you need someone to call time to just kind of reel you back, pump the brakes a bit. Just kind of allow you to take a deep breath.
It's a very coachable team, young, but they got up to SEC speed and have turned it up in the postseason. Blue-collar program, and that is a point of emphasis for Kentucky. They have to earn the right to wear blue with a common set of standards they have in fall camp. And it has really paid off well for this Kentucky team this year. And it looks like Redflake is going to have to work out of another jam here in this 4th inning. Chased a high one and a slow roller, and it is a fair ball. And Metzger applies the tag to retire Camuso. Rhodes down to 2nd.
This looked to be a hit and run situation. You see that pitch as a pitch she will not normally swing at. Rhodes was going on the base pass. She was able to sacrifice her over. Metzger picks it up, applies the tag.
Now Miranda Elish, another lefty-lefty matchup. Redflake working out of a 2nd and 3rd jam in the 1st. Base runners in the 2nd and 3rd innings as well. Bouncer charging Reed. Only play at 1st in time. 2 down. Kentucky committed just 1 error in the regional, and it was Reed, believe it or not, but she is so steady over there, makes tough plays look routine.
Yeah, she's a stud, and you have Rhodes running in front of her on that play as well, so you have the speed of Elish from the left side, the runner in front of you, it's a lot going on, and she's able to make a clean play for the out.
Lauren Lindvall, good stop by the catcher, Shaper.
Lindvall having a heck of an at-bat versus her. Last time, seeing close to 12 pitches, ended up getting the base hit. Redflake has to be careful here with a runner on.
Good rip there, 1-1. Lindvall, an all-regional pick from Stevenson Ranch, California. Last year, 3rd team all Pac-12. Pac-12 all-freshman pick a couple years ago. Now, you've got first base open here, but it doesn't really help to pitch around Lindvall, does it, with Lily on deck?
I mean, it's kind of one of those things. Would you rather face a righty or a lefty? I mean, Lily's being a lefty in the 9 slot, and you've got Lindvall who's on you. The base hitter last at bat coming from the right side, so it just depends Redflake's comfort zone.
Two and two here, chance to get out of this inning. Full count. Mike White's team has stranded four already. Ball four. Third walk given up by Aaron Rutledge. So will be Lilly. Runners on the corners here. Glad you're with us. We're at the Super Regional. Game two, best of three. The winner of this series heads to Oklahoma City. Trey Bender alongside two-time Player of the Year, Danielle Laurie. Oregon winning game one 4-0, but Kentucky with a two spot in the first. And Erin Rethlake has battled through some jams, and she's trying to get through another one to keep her team in front.
Sooner or later, though, if you just continue to keep playing with fire, you're going to get burned. Rethlake has to sharpen up, limit those walks, already has three. And not getting ahead. If you don't get ahead, you have to bring the ball more over the plate, and that's when trouble hits.
Spellman continues to warm up, a right-hander for UK. Fly ball to center. Hines backed up a few steps, makes the catch, and that ends the inning. Still 2-0 Wildcats as we head to the bottom of the fourth. We'll hear from Kentucky head coach Rachel Lawson when we come back. Leading Oregon game two of this best of three with the Ducks up 1-0. We go to the bottom of the fourth and we're joined by Rachel Lawson, the Cats coach. Erin Rethlake, the decision over Prince. Talk about that heading in here.
Well, Erin's been doing a great job for us the last 3 weeks. So I thought we need a little bit of change, a little change in pace in terms of speed. Erin throws the ball a little bit harder. I thought they would have a harder time barreling up on the ball.
Coach, backs against the wall in this game. Talk a little bit about the conversation you had with your team heading into game two today.
Well, we just talked about the fact that yesterday we didn't play our game at all. We knew what they were going to do, and we just didn't respond. We let them have it. So in order to be in this game, you're going to have to play the game the way we've been playing it all year, or you're going home.
Perfect. Thanks so much, Coach.
All right,
good
thank
luck.
Thank you.
Yeah.
This is a team with a lot of character. You never want to be in an elimination-type setting, but they seem to handle it pretty well. And let's see if they can add to their lead. Abby Cheek to lead things off against Maggie Ballant.
And they look like a different team. I mean, offensively, they've put some runs up early, but most importantly, defensively, they've made routine plays, and they've also made some big-time plays, and that's defense fires people up. So when you see those types of plays, that really gets you going as a team and gets you going in the circle.
Cheek made one of those plays at the hot corner, turning a double play. The Kentucky team is 12-12 in the SEC, but swept through the Lexington Regional, beating DePaul and Illinois twice. Oregon with a 14-game winning streak on the line here. Look at Udria shading her face from the sun there at shortstop. 1-2, hammered to left, down the line, gone! Abby Cheek, 3-0 Wildcats.
Abby Cheek with her 13th dinger of the year. Rise ball up in the zone, gets barrel on ball and just tags this out of here. Great piece of hitting, only a sophomore, but fire me up, Abby Cheek.
Now Breanne Ray. And stunned silence here from the Ducks fans at Sanders Stadium.
And that didn't even look like that bad of a pitch at a 1-2 count. I mean, it was up in the zone. I really think that was just a solid piece of hitting from Cheek, getting barrel on ball. There you go, there you go.
Linval retires Ray for the first out.
And Coach Lawson said she can break out at any moment. I mean, she's been somewhat consistent in postseason, but not that.
The first UK player to have 20 plus home runs in her first 2 years, Abby Cheek. Adding to the Cats' advantage, Metzger goes opposite field, but working towards the line, Mercado is there. Two out. This Sunday morning, E60 will profile the Nashville Predators Stanley Cup final bound defenseman, PK Subban. Start your Sunday with a story, 9 a.m. Eastern on ESPN, also streaming live on the ESPN app. Kentucky trying to square this best of three series at a game apiece. Here's Bailey Vick. You know, the move of Vick to the eighth spot hasn't helped her out, but Shaper delivered in that number two spot in the order, normally Vick's spot. It's worked out well for Rachel Lawson. Vick in a bit of a funk right now. 1-for-12 in the postseason, but if she gets on, she's very dangerous. Chops at it. Easy play for Udria. And that'll end the inning. Abby Cheek, the star of the Wildcats fourth, pulls it down the line. 3-0 lead for UK. Big win for the Aggies, thanks Adnan. Maybe a surprise here, Kentucky, a 3-0 leader top of the fifth. Erin Rethlake has worked out of some jams and she'll get the top part of the Ducks order. Danica Mercado leading things off for Oregon, who has stranded six already in this one.
Mercado going through the third time she's going to be facing Rethlake. Look for Oregon to make adjustments on her.
You never want to pitch with runners on, but she has had a composure about her as you see Prince warming up.
Yeah, and you always have a little bit extra adrenaline when there's runners on base. And
backhanded by Martins. The one hopper is thrown away. Mercado on her way to second. The throw is there. And they got her. One down. The gamble there on the throwing error, and they lose a base runner.
And it has been defense all day. Martins, if Metzger was able to make a good pick, she would have been out at first, but it was the throw by Shaper. Out by a mile, Mercado. Should not have went on that. Clearly she knows that, but it's the heads up D. Shaper covering. If Shaper doesn't cover, you're not able to get that ball as quick and you're not able to come up with the big throw. And Kentucky defense today is night and day different than yesterday.
Yeah, that hustle play, one to keep a note on. Shows you if you don't give up on a play, good things can happen. Alexis Mack, Reed on the run. Not in time. Mack again beats it out. Her second infield single.
And this is all Reed can do with this. Mack has so much speed. Reed throws a cannon on the run. Awful close.
Gwen Savekas. This is a duck you don't want to make a mistake to. You can sense that she has found her rhythm at the plate after a couple hits yesterday.
That's where just those base running miscues. Mercado would be runners on first and second right now with Savekas and Udria coming up. Those can hurt you. And you're right, with Sveka stepping up, no one's feeling it right now more than her. Maybe Mac with a couple hits, but Gwen Sveka is settling in nicely.
2-1. Well, Redflake hasn't made it easy on for herself out there in the circle, but now a conference with the catcher, Schaefer.
And it really just makes you think, like, how tight is this leash here? I mean, Rethlick's got herself out of some big jams. Defense has come up clutch for her, but you have Prince in the pen. If anything gets too close, I mean, I'd be pulling the chute pretty quick and bringing the senior in. Oregon, not a lot of innings left to try to scrape away some runs.
2-1 to the Ducks, catcher misses. Now it's 3-1. Heart of the order for the Ducks here. Sveckis, Udria, the cleanup hitter on deck. Here's a look at the line for Aaron.
And the last thing you want to do is bring that tying run to the plate by walking Gwen.
Off speed misses. Runners at first and second now. Four walks given up by Aaron Rethlick. And the tying run comes to the plate. Nikki Udria, who has reached on a fielder's choice, but that double play was big to end the third inning.
I must say that umpire has a small zone. I mean, that's the frustrating part about pitchers. You have to find that zone, and clearly she's not changing it. So Rethlick has to find a different approach here of how to get ahead of hitters. Falling behind is tough. You can't do it. Four walks today proves that it is a tight zone. She just has to find a way, I guess, to mentally battle, because that can be the most challenging thing as a pitcher.
Kentucky can get through this inning unscathed. You know, how demoralizing would it be for the Ducks if they can't score here? They've stranded base runners in every inning.
And this is when Oregon needs to step up. You have one of your best hitters in Udria, leads in ribbies, leads in home runs, can tie this ball game up with one swing.
Good rip there, 1-1. Look at that career, top five in a number of categories, including hits and RBIs. That's a strike on the corner. She's also on the cusp of being number two all time in runs and RBIs at Oregon. A tremendous career. Big opportunity here in the fifth. Pulls it foul.
This could be one of the biggest at-bats for Udria this year. I mean, one out, you got Ducks on the pond.
2-2, check swing, no, says Steve McCown down the third baseline. You're 2-2 here in your Rethlick. You don't want to make a mistake. Where are you going?
I mean, that curve is, it's her bread and butter. She's just had a tough time locating it. If she can get it tight in the outside corner.
Goes outside with it and it's fouled off.
And Udria doing a great job of fouling that pitch off. Rethlick able to throw that change, but just would need to locate it. And perfect placement here with this 2-2 count. You don't want anything too out of the zone. See what she goes with.
Full count.
And with Shannon Rhodes on deck, I mean, walking to a bases loaded with Rhodes, there's no end in sight. She's a hot hitter as well. Rethlick, see what she does.
Ball four and the bases are loaded. Five walks now for Rethlick. Here comes Coach Lawson. Yeah. Bases loaded. Aaron Rethlake has worked out of jams in every inning. And that will be it for the left-hander. The ace, Megan Prince, will get the call when we come back. She's in the circle, but the Cats up 3-0. Drama here in Eugene. Kentucky has dominated. Aaron Rethlake has worked out of jams, but she gives way now to Megan Prince with UK up 3-0. The base is full, one out. And they're going to the ace in a relief role. She has 5 saves this year.
And your blood's got to be pumping. You're coming in here, bases loaded situation. Prince saw him yesterday. I mean, she's got that drop curve on the outer half. This is when you utilize that senior experience. Slow the game down, one pitch at a time. We'll see what she's made of.
The loser in game one, as they were shut out 4-0, has 21 wins. Second all-time in career saves at Kentucky, and the first offering to Shannon Rhodes. Misses for ball one. At third base, the Ducks have Alexis Mack, plenty of speed. Cevekas at second, and Udria at first. And Udria represents the tying run. And a run's gonna come in here. And Rachel Lawson wants an explanation.
And I don't like that call one bit. Prince threw yesterday, did not get one illegal pitch called. And he calls it with bases loaded. I completely disagree with that, and that is frustrating.
Max scores on the illegal pitch to make it 3-1.
Looks good to me.
And now a single can tie it up with Rhodes at the plate, the count 2-0. Ground ball, knocked down by Reed, and she throws out Rhodes for the second out. How about that, keeping this a 3-2 game. RBI for Rhodes.
Are you kidding me? Katie Reed, absolutely unbelievable. She just saved this game from being tied up. One of the best shortstops I've seen. Look at this layout. Oh my goodness. She comes up, understands that Rhodes has speed, gets that out. Man, I'm in awe up here. That was amazing.
The Wildcats defense has been rock solid. Here's Camuso. First pitch, liner, Reed's got it. And she makes another play at shortstop for the Wildcats. 4.5 complete, and Kentucky stays in front. 3-2. Wildcats trying to keep their season going. Randa Ellis taking over for the Ducks in the circle for Maggie Ballant, who goes 4 innings and allows 3 runs on 5 hits. She pitched in the regional, beating Wisconsin in a great effort. Their number 3 pitcher, all freshman pick out of the Pac-12.
Yeah, and she throws the hardest out of any pitcher in the super regional right now. She's a drop pitcher, keeps that ball down in the zone. She's gotten hot late in season, last couple Pac-12 games, as well as regionals last weekend. She can throw that ball hard. She hits the upper 60s, and with this type of adrenaline, big crowd, you're down by one. Let's hope she can contain that.
Kentucky's defense, the reason they are still in front. Katie Reed with a diving play. And they're still up 3-2. Despite an illegal pitch that scored a run and an RBI single by Shannon Rhodes in that last half. Here's Aaron Rethlake leading it off for the Wildcats. Rethlake, a slapper who has turned her game around. You see Katie Reed, she's the top of the order, and a chance to get some speed on the base pass here for UK. Ellis from Crown Point, Indiana, all region pick. Did a good job at the plate and had the shutout against the Badgers.
And Ella Ellis, only a freshman as well in the circle. Let's not forget, they don't understand this postseason type feel. They have to come in and really get a feel for it. You want to come in with a bang right away. You don't want to fall too far behind, especially with Rethlick in the nine hole. You can turn that lineup around quickly.
She's fifth in the Pac-12 in ERA this season as a freshman. 3-1 offering is fouled off. Not your typical freshman, the nation's number one recruit, but again, first Supers opportunity. We saw her shine in the regionals.
In postseason, there is so much different emotions and there is a lot more pressure. It doesn't matter what you say to these athletes, there's pressure.
High chopper, Lindblad. One down. Now the top of the order for Kentucky, Katie Reed, who has flashed the leather at shortstop and has to be a all-super regional possibility after being all-regional at Lexington last week. What a postseason for Katie. Take strike one. Has six hits in postseason play. Hammers that one down the line, and it is off the wall, foul. Just foul. She almost took it out of here.
Oh my goodness. It's a game of inches. You see that shadow. Oh my goodness. Man, oh man. Ellis, gotta be careful.
Two strike offering, popped up. Lindvall again, two down.
And two quick outs for Ellis. Long fly ball, looks like a home run, but just another strike on the board, able to get a quick out and Reed as well as Rethlick, try to get her team back in there, keep that momentum train going.
Jenny Shaper and an opposite field single her last time up in the third. We're still shaking our heads over that Katie Reed play the last half inning. You know, you probably see the old footage of Brooks Robinson, the Hall of Famer back. She extended. That's got to be one of the top plays in postseason.
Oh, 100%. Not to mention that it saved the game and still gives them the lead going into the fifth inning. It's one of the best plays that I've ever seen a shortstop make. And the crazy thing is she's just moved to shortstop this year. She was an everyday second baseman last year.
It's got to be a Sports Center top 10 nominee.
I'm going top three, Trey.
I might go number one there. Shaper to third, Lily. And it's bobbled by Camuso, and Shaper safe, an error. Keeps the inning going.
And Lily usually comes up with these types of plays. She had lots of time. She's not able to get that throw up, and Camuso wasn't able to handle it.
And now Brooklyn Hines with two down. First pitch fouled off. Oregon 16-21 first pitch strike, so they're pitching right at Kentucky at the beginning of the count.
And we all know the importance of that, especially with Ellis just coming in. I mean, there's a lot pumping through your veins. You need to kind of slow the game down, get ahead. And the importance of first pitch strikes limit the free passes that you get. If you get behind, you have to bring ball over plate, and that's when great hitters are going to dominate you if you throw the ball over the way to the plate. Getting behind in 0-2 counts are sometimes the most difficult to throw in. 0-2 counts, sometimes you can be a little too careful and drift over plate as well.
Just off the baseline, strike three call. They say Hines committed on it. Jim Bertuzzi with the call down the first baseline. We're through five, runner stranded, still a one-run game. Kentucky trying to keep their season going. Two Wildcats lead the Ducks. Airtight defense from Kentucky as we move to the top of the sixth inning.
And it's been Katie Reed. I mean, she's stepped up huge. You see her here make this big play to get Mercado out at home in the rundown. Cheek able to lay the tag. And you have Cheek with that big double play that got them out of a big jam. And this, I mean, this is, you see Martin's there, able to get that. The backup by Schaefer. But what I meant was this. I mean, this play is unbelievable. She gets it, lays out, saves the run from tying the ball game, and is able to get Rhodes out plenty of time. I mean, Katie Reed, you have a fan up here in the booth.
Randa Ellish to Cheek at third, and that left side of the infield continues to get it done as Prince gets the ground out, one away.
There's not many outs left for Oregon here. They have five outs. They really need to have good quality at bats. It's just a one-run ball game. I mean, I know a home run can tie it, but quality at bats, try to see a good amount of pitches and do some damage.
Lauren Lindvall, first pitch swinging, fouls it off. Both teams have been aggressive early in the count throughout the course of this game.
And Ellis, first pitch swinging, gets herself out. And Lindvall has had a good quality at bat. Her last couple with the big walk as well as that single, she's seen a lot of pitches.
Martin's at second, two up and two down. The Women's College World Series returns to Oklahoma City. The action begins Thursday, noon Eastern, live on ESPN. For more information on the 2017 Women's College World Series, visit NCAA.com, the official online home for all 90 NCAA championships. The top 16 seeds advancing to Supers, and it'd be Pac-12 and SEC heavy. Oregon trying to get back to the Women's College World Series for the first time since 2015, but Kentucky trying to even this at a game apiece. Jenna Lilly now.
And Oregon will get another crack at the top of their lineup, getting a chance at Prince.
Who is headed to OKC? Well, these three, UCLA, Oklahoma, Florida. Great tradition for those three schools.
It's always nice to get those punched and then watch everyone else. You're like, oh, I feel good. We got this.
Lilly will have to protect the plate now, one and two.
Couple other series, that Tennessee A&M series going to game three, and you saw that LSU Florida State. That's when you appreciate having another full day where you can go rest, watch film, and get yourself ready for game three.
2-2 is pulled to the first baseman Rethlake to end the inning. Kentucky defense does the job again. Still a 3-2 lead for Big Blue Nation.
Thursday, June 1st on the networks of ESPN.
The NCAA Women's Softball Super Regionals presented by Capital One continues. Kentucky trying to stave off elimination here. If necessary, game three coverage begins Sunday, 3 Eastern time. And the winner of this series will play Utah or Washington in the Women's College World Series. Game two of the series coming up tonight at 9 Eastern time on ESPN2. All games streaming live on the ESPN app and watch ESPN. Wildcats have the lead, and Alex Martin's at the plate as we open up the bottom half of the sixth inning. The Wildcats, the home team here, Martins is 1-for-2. She drove in a run with a double in the first. Lifted down the line, foul, and out of play. Martins had a great Lexington Regional, 2-run home run against Illinois. SEC all-freshman pick. Mentally tough, you could say that about a lot of the Wildcats. Look who's on deck, Abby Cheek. Flare and a foul ball, just foul down the left field line.
There's been a couple balls that.
Flare and a foul ball, just foul down the left field line.
There's been a couple balls that.
Would love an opportunity with a runner aboard. Solo home run in the fourth. They're looking for a little breathing room. Here in Eugene. Would love an opportunity with a runner aboard. Solo home run in the fourth. They're looking for a little breathing room here in Eugene.
Get some quick outs heading into the top of the seventh inning.
Katie Reed looking on. Here's a 3-2. That's hit hard and into the gap in right center field. Martins will take a big turn and hold on.
Get some quick outs heading into the top of the seventh inning.
Katie Reed looking on. Here's a 3-2. That's hit hard and into the gap in right center field. Martins will take a big turn and hold on.
Gave them the go-ahead, and Oregon trying to fight back, but without Cheek's home run, this would be a tie ball game. Look at that number, 23 homers in her first two seasons. Gave them the go-ahead, and Oregon trying to fight back, but without Cheek's home run, this would be a tie ball game. Look at that number, 23 homers in her first two seasons.
That's Kelsey Henson now running at first base, sophomore from Paducah, Kentucky, at first with Cheek at the plate. From Inman, South Carolina, top prospect from that state. Just a sophomore. Late on that swing. Mention her home run totals, we just saw them. She also has a UK record for RBIs over her first 2 years.
You see her going with the bunt, trying to get on time, brings that swing back.
Chase one there, one down. Studio update, Adnan Vert. Thanks, guys. Bottom of the sixth, one out, one on, and Breanne Ray for the Wildcats. Seen a lot of talented freshmen and sophomores in the Super Regional. Two of the most talented teams, two of the most talented young teams in postseason in the country. And Ellis is really bringing the heat right now.
She sure is. Yeah, she had Cheek swinging and missing that down ball, and Ray taking her hacks as well. Like I said, Ellis can get it in those upper 60s.
Three-time Gatorade Indiana Player of the Year. Has had a breakthrough freshman campaign here at Oregon. 1-2, and that's fouled off. Ray staying alive. Brianne with a career best season at the plate, coming in hitting 278. To short, and the first play for out number two. They cut down the lead runner, Martins, there, and Elishe out away from getting out of the sixth. Now Rachel Metzger, and the good news for the Wildcats here, she has 8 home runs. She's a power hitter against a power pitcher. She has the ability to take it out.
When you're facing someone like Ella, she don't need to supply a lot of power. Like I said, she can get up to 68, 70 miles an hour. So not trying to have too big of a swing. She's trying to be short and sweet to the ball.
That hit is hit well into right center and off the fence. Ray rounding third's gonna hold on. They're gonna keep her at third, a double for Metzger, who tattoos it to right center field.
What a piece of hitting. I mean, this has drifted over the plate, but exactly what I'm talking about. Doesn't need to supply too much power short to the ball. Hit that thing so hard that wasn't able to score her from first. She's got a lot of speed, but good holdout. You don't want to be that third out at home. Just going to pass the bat.
So the Wildcats trying to deliver with two outs, and it'll be the speedy Bailey Vick coming up, and now a meeting in the circle. Mike White headed out there.
Just going out and having a chat about what Vic brings to the table. Coming up in the 8 hole, I mean, she's not a big power hitter. She's usually up there in the 2 slot. Today she's moved down to the 8 spot. She's got that soft slap, slaps a little bit, sometimes hits away, but not your typical big bopper.
Bryn Bigelow now pinch running at second for Metzger. Wildcats looking for some insurance here in the bottom of the 6th. Rachel Lawson has speed at the plate in Vic. They'll be aware of a potential bunt here. She can beat it out.
And look at the infield. Yeah, look at the infield. They're all so in, understanding that she doesn't have a big hit game. She's all short game.
And she's hit by the pitch. Coming in high and tight, and the bases are loaded.
And that hurts. It's one of those ones where you're awful mad. It didn't fully get your brace there. It looked like it kind of nicked something else. That does hurt.
Smile from Vic over there. And now the base is full for Aaron Rethlake, another slapper.
And if you're Kentucky, this is when you want to add another 1-2 runs insurance heading into the top of the 7th inning, knowing that Oregon has their leadoff coming up to the plate.
And nowhere to put Rethlake. She's grounded out a couple times to short and to second. Breakthrough season, week 2, she became a slapper and has flourished. Here's the 1-0. Had a piece of that one, foul tip, 1-1. Third base is Ray. Bigelow at second. And Vic at first. Ellis trying to keep this a one-run game. Pulled in the hole into right field. That scores Ray. Here comes Bigelow. She scores. 2 more across for the Cats, and they lead it 5-2.
breath leg, turns on that, and does a great job of just getting it through. And that's a routine play that can be made if defense is back. But because they are pulled in a little bit, not able to get that. I think that that's a ball that Linval at second can usually get to.
Now Katie Reed trying to add to the lead, looks at strike one.
Those are two big insurance runs heading into the top of the seventh.
Runners on the corners, and Rachel Lawson out with a few words for the home plate umpire, Leah Bowen.
A lot of times coaches will kind of do that just to get in the pitcher's head. I mean, understanding Elish is a freshman, you want to keep her out there by herself a little bit in the circle.
0-2. Looking ahead to the seventh, it will be the top of the order for the Ducks, but they'll have some work to do. How big a deficit will it be? You see the 21 pitches already for Elish this inning. Punches at it, foul. Just trying to protect the plate there, Reed. The St. Louis product has been sensational defensively. She has a single and a run scored. A chance to add to the lead for Kentucky. Swing and a miss, and that'll end the inning. Elish gets the K, but two more across for Kentucky. Could be the Ducks' last chance. Top of the order through six. Mercado to lead it off. Beautiful look at the Pacific Northwest. The Kentucky Wildcats have led all the way, trying to square the Super Regionals at a game apiece in front 5-2 after getting a couple insurance runs in the bottom half of the sixth inning. Top of the order for Oregon, Danica Mercado against Megan Prince, working in relief of Aaron Reflick. This is who you want up there if you're the team in green. Mercado, very good on the base pass, as is Alexis Mack. They need some base runners. And that's a base hit to right field. That's a good start.
Mercado having a day, adding another hit, giving her a good amount in the day.
Let's look ahead to our next game. Here's Adnan Virk. We have a dandy here, 5-2 lead. The Cats have out hit the Ducks 8-7 in this one, but Oregon, the top of their order, Mercado on, Mack at the plate. This is where they do a lot of their damage with their first two, and they'd like to bring the big hitter. Savekas is on deck and try to do some damage with the long ball.
At the top of their order here can get on base. This game is by no means over. Three runs ties this up, but the top of their lineup so dangerous.
Prince is after her sixth save. There's Savekas, who has a hit and a couple walks so far. Shots. Prince, not in time, she throws it away. Mercado rounding third, and the Ducks have runners at second and third after the throw in.
These Ducks are not going down without a fight, and this is just a play that you don't need to make if you're Prince. You're not going to get Mack with that speed. And rushing is what the speed of Mack does to a defense. She allows for them to freak out and try to make those type of big throws, and Prince throwing it away puts those two runners closer to scoring. I think she just needs to find a way to slow the game down right now. Realize it's 5-2. Those two runs don't matter. A home run, yes, that matters. You can't bring anything too sweet over the plate. But if Svekas gets a base hit where those two score, it does not matter because it won't tie this ball game up. It's all about outs.
Tying run at the plate. Svekas, her only hit in the third inning, a solid single to left. Oregon with a win can punch their ticket to the Women's College World Series for the fourth time in 6 years. A lot of work to do against Megan Prince. First base is open. You see what Gwen has done with runners in scoring position.
When you'll see really what Prince is made of. I mean, you talk about pressure, your season's on the line, you have a three-run cushion, but you feel that, you feel the adrenaline.
Just missed with that one, 3-1.
I don't think you can paint a prettier spot. I think this umpire is changing up her zone a little bit. And it can be frustrating here in the circle, but she is poker face, I dig it.
Bases loaded. Tying run at third. And the go-ahead run comes to the plate. Nikki Udria. Udria's walked. Grounded out a couple times.
You see Katie Reed throw her hands up in the air with frustration. I want to know where those are missing.
Bouncer through and into the outfield. Mercado scores. Max scores. And it's a one-run game.
About a change in momentum. Udria takes this curve on the outer half and just hits it up the middle. Does enough to score those two runs and just pass the bag. That's what this Oregon team needs to do. Continue to pass the bag. And Mac is fired up.
Now Svekas at second represents the tying run. Udria at first, the go-ahead run. Still nobody out. And it's a dangerous Shannon Rhodes coming up next. RBI single last time up. Ball one outside. Prince cannot get that strike call on the outside part of the plate.
She cannot. She's just having a tough time finding the zone. It's changed up a little bit here late in the game.
Rhodes is going to lay one down. Prince only play it first. They get the first down. Advancing to second and third on the sacrifice. The Ducks now have the tying run at third base and the go-ahead at second.
And I love that. Shannon Rhodes able to drop that sacrifice bunt to move those players 60 feet. Let's remember, they're still behind here. They have to score that run from third, and that's the winning run on second base. So for her to come up in that situation, lay that down, Prince had to make a great play, which she did, but it moved those runners. Fundamentals of this game, ABCs of softball. Now someone needs to step up with a big base hit.
Mia Camuso can put him in front. Ball one. 0-for-3, has flied out, grounded out, and lined out. And another position again where you've got first base open. Elish is on deck for the Ducks. Rachel Lawson's team trying to hang on here. Keep their season going. 2-1.
If she can get that call, Prince needs to go back there. That's a pitch that's been called and then not. But if she can find a way to hit that exact same spot again against the lefty, that curve spin away.
Hold it, just foul down the first base line. That would have played it a couple and put him in front.
This is so close. There's been a lot today that have been so close to the line that could be game changers, but they've gone foul.
Down the left field line, it's going to drop for a base hit. One run scores. Two run score, and the Ducks in front.
Drops this down in front of Vic. There's just nothing you can do on that. Svekas was tagging. Udre able to play it, and what a momentum booster. Oregon scoring four in the top of the seventh, giving themselves the lead.
Mia Camuso, a freshman from Redding, California. A young, talented Ducks team stepping up here in the top half of the seventh. A four-run top half, and now Maddie Bishop's going to get an opportunity, hitting an Elish spot in the order.
This umpire is giving Prince absolutely nothing. It's forced her at times to bring that ball a little bit more over the plate.
Gets the strike call there, 1-1. Bishop, a sophomore from Jonesboro, Arkansas. Time to get him an insurance run here at the top of the seventh. She has rotated in the DP role with Elish in that bottom part of the order. Three and one. Oregon with the win is off to the Women's College World Series for the fourth time in 6 years. Bishop, high fly ball to center. Backing up, Hines makes the catch. Camuso will stay put at second, two down. Now Lauren Lindvall. A two-run fifth and a four-run seventh. What a rally from Oregon here. They have now out-hit Kentucky 10-8 in this one. Looking ahead to Kentucky's home half of the seventh, it'll be Shaper, Hines, and Martin scheduled up. 2-3 and four hitters. 1-2. He's had a wide range of emotions here. It's been a roller coaster ride.
See Elish throwing in the pen. It's been a long inning. I told you this Oregon team starting off at the top of the lineup in the seventh. We're not going down without a fight. And wow, coming up scoring four runs here and giving themselves the go ahead headed into the bottom of the seventh.
That's Camuso at second. This is the eighth hitter in this inning, Lauren Lindvall. Glove by Reflet, good play to the bag to end the inning. Mia Camuso, though, delivers. A clutch double for Oregon.
And Camuso comes up big, gives him the go-ahead, gets a couple runs. UK's back against the wall. We'll see what they're made of here, bottom seven.
The Oregon Ducks a step away from the Women's College World Series, leading Kentucky 6-5 after a four-run top of the seventh. It would be the Ducks' fourth trip in the last six seasons to Oklahoma City. What a rally as they sent eight to the plate in the top half, and now Miranda Elish will try to close the door and end Kentucky's season.
And we'll see what she's made of. Freshman in the circle here. A lot of pressure riding. I mean, you saw what Oregon did coming up with their backs against the wall. Put up a big four spot there to give them the go ahead. We'll see if Elish can come in and shut the door.
Kentucky had a 5-2 lead. They set the tone early with Aaron Reflake starting, and then Prince came in, and the Ducks got it going in the seventh to seize control here. And now they'll try to bring it home. Elish, one of the top freshmen in the country, will work to the catcher, Jenny Shaper. Kentucky's big hitters have a chance here if Shaper or Hines can reach. Martins and Cheek in the four and five spots in the order. Ducks warming up Megan Kleist.
And why not? You look at how she pitched the other day. If Elish gets in trouble, you can always bring her in.
Shaper with a count of 1-2 now. Ducks on a 14-game winning streak, 51-6 this year. NCAA record 35-0 start. Finished second to Arizona in the Pac-12. Kentucky a breakthrough year at 39-18. They've been a model of consistency under Rachel Lawson, nine straight NCAAs. But they could go home today. Pulled foul. Well, Elish closed out the regional with the victory over Wisconsin.
She got herself back in this, got behind a little bit, but let's see if she can pull the trigger here.
Chase the high heater, one down.
That's got to fire you up. She goes upstairs, usually stays down, but throws a rise up in the zone, which completely changes Shaper's eyes. Big K to start off the bottom of the seventh.
She's been good in relief of Maggie Ballant, who went four innings. Now Brooklyn Hines has five home runs. Singled and scored her first time up. Hines is Kentucky's hardest worker. Spends the most time in the batting cage. Will it pay off with a big AB here? Oh, she's out in front of that one. Hits it hard, foul. Long trip from Lexington to Eugene, Oregon. Kentucky trying to keep their season going, force a game three tomorrow. Three and one. There's Kleist again, just in case. Pulled foul towards the bullpen. Win number 40 would be huge for Kentucky, but they need base runners. That's fouled off. She goes, and the Ducks are now away from the Women's College World Series.
That's got to feel good if you're Elish. Two big strikeouts.
The freshman Miranda Elish will face Alex Martins. Oregon unfinished business last year, losing to UCLA on this field in the Supers after winning game one. Trying to close this one out in two games. Get back to Oklahoma City, a big moment, and Mike White out there with a quick chat with his freshman.
Yeah, and you're right. There's so much on the line. You don't want to go to game three. And look, you look at what Oregon did, scraped away to put four big runs up on the board. Elish comes in and gets two big strikeouts. And the last thing you want to do is go to a game three. It gives that team momentum. And she's got one tough out here at the plate, Martins. Two freshmen, big showdown.
She has a double and a single already in three trips. Yeah. 2-0. Martins has four home runs this year. She's had a big postseason with seven hits. Yeah. 2-1. Freshman from Crown Point, Indiana, trying to close the door. Here's the 2-1. Swing and a miss. The Ducks are a strike away.
And I'm going back upstairs. If Elish can locate that pitch again. Strike away from the Women's College World Series.
Stays alive, getting a piece of that one. Standing here at Sanders Stadium, great atmosphere, and they're trying to cheer the Ducks to OKC. Bouncer to third, Lily. The Oregon Trail leads to Oklahoma City.
What a comeback.
For the fourth time in the last 6 years, Oregon headed to the Women's College World Series. Our Capital One player of the game, Mia Camuso.
Yeah, you've got to give it to her. She's the one that allowed for this situation to happen, for them to come in the go-ahead and come out here with this win. Clutch hitting for these guys, and it was Camuso with a big hit to left field that allowed for them to head to the Women's College World Series.
So we advance the Oregon Ducks to OKC as they win it in 2 games over Kentucky. They'll meet the winner of Washington, Utah. It'll be a Pac-12 rematch in Oklahoma.
Yeah, and we shall see. We'll see who comes out of that Washington-Utah bracket, but Oregon has punched its ticket. Man, oh man, they are a great team to watch. I'm excited to see what they can do.
Our final score, 6-5 for Danielle Laurie. I'm Trey Bender. Coming up next, Arizona and Baylor, more NCAA softball super regional coverage. That's the story from Eugene, Oregon. Ducks advance. Mia Camuso, one of the stars for the Ducks, a big two-run double in the seventh. Talk about your at-bat that put your team in front.
It was a tough at-bat. I got down with 2 strikes, and I just wanted to pull through for my team because they got on base, and it was my turn to get a hit that at-bat.
Now, you're a freshman. I know a lot of players, teammates on your squad appreciate getting this super regional victory after coming up so close last year. Did some of the veterans talk to you about unfinished business this year?
Yeah, for sure. I just really wanted to get it for our seniors, Nikki, Sammy, and Danica, and it was really important for us to get to OKC for them.
How about your offense? You've had a few ups and downs, but it seems like you're really clicking right now. Up and down the lineup, is it the versatility the key thing with this Duck squad?
Yeah, for sure. I mean, we have our people in the top of the order that can do the drag bunt and the slap, and then we just have our power hitters and our base hitters, get them in.
Mia, thanks. Enjoy this one.
Thank you so much.